So the last example that we have for the time being, and of course, for anybody that is watching online, the plan is to produce even more of these as we get more examples and more signatures down the line. But for the time being, the last example is simply a light winter precipitation event. And this sort of just shows the ability of polarimetric data or dual-pol data to discriminate different regimes, different precipitation regimes, and give you a much better idea of how even a light winter precipitation event is evolving. But just because the precipitation is light, can still mean big impacts. We've seen some cases, both here in Oklahoma City and around the country, where some very light freezing rain has turned a metro area into absolute chaos because it's getting a light coating of ice on everything and people don't really notice it. And before they know it, they're driving off the roads because they were going too fast. And so we want to identify these areas better with dual-pol data. So let's imagine a case where we're getting just very low-level light, very light precipitation to form. We imagine in this case, throughout the atmosphere, we're dealing with temperatures that are sub-freezing below 0 degrees Celsius at 32 degrees Fahrenheit. Let's imagine we have a big layer of dry air aloft. We're not seeing any precipitation form up top, but we're saturated down low. So we got lots of clouds forming beneath our layer of dry air. And the temp is at or a little bit below, maybe a few degrees below freezing through this layer of colder air closer to the surface, or excuse me, not colder air, but just more moist air closer to the surface. So we're going to overlay a skew T and imagine what maybe our thermal and moisture profiles look like. So we can imagine our saturation here, and then once we get above, maybe into a subsident layer on top of our saturation, we see it dries out as our dew point drops off and our temperature curve follows a trace something like this. But here we have our saturation. Perhaps we're close to a warm front or we're north of a warm front where we're seeing this saturation on top of us. Or in the other instance, perhaps a cold front has moved through and we're seeing just up glide over top of our location as a cold front pushes farther and farther to the south. So the moist layer is only a few degrees below freezing. It's not that cold, as we can see. It's not like negative 10, negative 15, negative 20 degrees Celsius. So where we're generating our precipitation is too warm to generate ice crystals. Remember from our talk of ZDR columns, you get things known as supercooled liquid water, where it's below freezing, but it's not so cold that we're causing it to freeze into perhaps a sleep pellet, or we're not making an ice crystal from it. So we get these little raindrops or these little liquid drops, and it's super cooled liquid water. So often the result from a scenario such as this, and it's not too uncommon in the wintertime, is freezing drizzle or mist. It's a very light precipitation, getting hardly anything out of it, but things can get pretty slick, or maybe coated up our radar here, as you can see. So this is an example recently from here in central Oklahoma. On the left, we have reflectivity. On the right, we have correlation coefficient. And we highlight correlation coefficient because with reflectivity this light, we're talking like 0, 5 dBz, even negative dBz, so really light precipitation. We want to make sure we're dealing with meteorological scatters. So correlation coefficient is nice and high, so we feel good about it being a meteorological scatter. So it confirms we have very light precipitation. Let's look at ZDR to get an idea of the shape of the precipitation. And we see ZDR is pretty close to zero, about 0 dB. So what that tells us is we have generally perhaps something that's sort of spherical. Remember, we were dealing with, in our schematic, near surface conditions that were moist but very dry air aloft. And with this event, if we were to look at a skew T or we just had an idea of how the environment was evolving, we would know that it was very moist closer to the surface. Our precipitation was forming very close to the surface, and that's why it was so light, and it was very dry aloft. So we expect there to be supercooled liquid water, and indeed, ZDR is confirming that to us. These little spherical drops have equal components in the horizontal and the vertical, which will give us ZDR close to about 0 dB. Temps were below freezing at the time, though, so that tells us it's freezing drizzle. And freezing drizzle, as we've seen many examples recently here and again elsewhere, as I mentioned at the beginning, that it can cause a lot of havoc in the sense that often it's not very heavy, so people underestimate it, yet it creates a very thin layer of ice, and so it can lead to lots of accidents, things like that. So we want to spot it. This is where it gets really cool. As we move later in time, and we see another area of light reflectivity, but we zoom in on correlation coefficient, and we note, again, we see speckles of lower correlation coefficient. Some of it's due to ground clutter, but these higher areas of CC are associated with a good chunk of this reflectivity. And so it tells us we're dealing with light precipitation here as well, and not just non-meteorological scatters with clutter. we can see that here. And if we were to loop this and look up and down, we could see as well that it was meteorological scatters. But if we look at ZDR, it's very distinct from our area to the southeast. Look at our ZDR values here now. It's like 2, 3, 4 dB. So if we recall from ZDR, that's telling us something about the shape of our particles there as well. There's more horizontal than there is vertical component to them. So while in the southeast part of the area, we have supercooled liquid water in these drops, well, it can't be those because they would be giving us 0 dB as well farther northwest. We're dealing with actual little snow crystals, a very light snow that was generating farther northwest as we were starting to bring in better saturation aloft slowly across the area from the west to the east. And so just ZDR alone, using our knowledge of the thermal environment and where we're expecting to see our saturation, whether it be at low levels or higher levels, perhaps with the system incoming with better ascent aloft, we can tell that this is flurries and this is freezing drizzle based off of ZDR. And so where we might expect our biggest impact, maybe not so much the flurries, you know, they're just kind of gently floating down, not creating much issue, but farther southeast, maybe you're getting a light coating of glaze on everything and that's leading to all sorts of travel problems. And so let's say you're a forecaster, or you're on TV or something like that, you can maybe stress that this area of low reflectivity is much more impactful than this area of low reflectivity. And that's a pretty cool thing you can do right there with differential reflectivity. So this light winter precipitation, it's subtle on radar. Light precipitation, we're dealing maybe 0.5 dBZ, hardly anything in reflectivity, but it can be quite impactful. Of course, we want to utilize sounding and model data to diagnose what our expected precipitation type is, how it's going to evolve, but to really start to hone in on how it's changing in the nearcast or in the near term, we can use our dual-pol data to add confidence to what exactly we're dealing with in terms of the hydrometeor shapes, the sizes. Is it supercooled water? Is it freezing drizzle? Are they little flurries? Is it not going to be as impactful? These are the things we can do with the dual-pol data when we add it on top of what we know in terms of our thermal environment from our sounding model data and also from reports maybe that we may be getting on the ground from spotters and other individuals. And with that, we wrap up our light winter precipitation presentation.